So I'm primarily going to talk about the internet because we do live in an internet mediated world. And okay, so I found one thing that I didn't expect was when I asked you all, can you all survive a day without the internet? Most of you all said yes. And I actually thought a lot more people would say no. But it's still, we still can't deny the fact that internet is a part of our everyday life now. And it is a little difficult to imagine living without it completely. And when we were having those discussions, I noticed that a lot of us were talking about how it's easier to communicate and it's a great space for us to share our ideas and interact with people from across the world, which was something somebody said as well. The folks from MKSS were a little skeptical about technology, but I still think that the internet has done wonders, and I'm sure they wouldn't deny that either. So I'm going to start with this picture. I don't know about how many of you all follow social media. So there's this guy called Brandon Stanton who runs this blog called Humans of New York. So what he does is he goes around New York and takes pictures of people and asks them a story about themselves. Like, if you could give advice to a group of people, what would that advice be? Things like that. So his page on Facebook has received a lot of attention. And so from people from around the world follow him. And he has really interesting stories that he tells. So lately, he's been hopping around the world. And he's in India. And this was, I think, day before yesterday or 3 days ago, where he posted a picture of Central Park in CP. And he said, I'll be here at 6 p.m. today. And this happened. Okay, so this is a guy in New York who's running this page on Facebook. And he has such a huge following that this many people showed up just to meet him. Okay, and this is just any regular guy. So I thought that was a really good example of how, you know, social media and the internet has just changed the way we communicate with each other on a global scale. And other examples would be things like how, you know, the Arab Spring grew and then Occupy happened, things like that. And Dhruv also mentioned about online, how offline protests and everything are still being organized online and gathering support. Okay, so I thought I'll design this presentation as a, like it's a play. So there are some things that we don't see very blatantly when we use the internet. These are some things that we might have noticed off and on, but we don't think about it on a daily basis. So it's something that happens in the green room of the internet. And then later on, I'll come to the spotlight. So I want to ask you all a question. What is the internet? Anybody? Go for it, Akanksha. She has the mic. We got the cordless mics. Yay. Just for that, you'll have to answer the question, please, after yesterday's efforts. What is the internet?
A network of networks.
Okay. A network of networks is what Nandini said. Yes, Param.
I read the... Okay. Don't use this.
You can use
okay. it. Yeah. I read a very social definition of internet which impresses me most because precise technology can change. It says that internet is a social condition where everyone is connected with everyone with minimum intermediations.
Okay.
This is foul actually. Two IT for change people have answered the question, but anyway we'll play the game.
Anybody else? It's a very, I mean, I don't know how I would answer the question myself. So
yeah,
it's an interface of technology with people in, it's a particularly broad-based interface of technology with people.
Okay. I think she wanted, Jani.
It's a half foul again.
Clever one, so I'm going to take a go at. I think it's an international net to net everybody, all the people in.
Pun intended.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Fisherman's net.
Then,
this isn't very thought through, but I, since yesterday, through all the discussions, I've been trying to look at it as an opportunity to create or a space which hosts a different set of identities for people.
So medium, for me it's a medium to reach out to people, access information, express myself, especially to people I can't in person.
Right.
And to think
like Pony.
For me, it's like a different world altogether. People on ground speaks different language. They pose or they look different. So I think it's like in Mahabharata, there's some Maya kind of world. So not Jal, Maya Jal, there's some illusion kind of. So many of people create illusion. I think this is because it's in a phase. Earlier phase, and they'll come. Eventually, everybody will come on the ground.
Internet to me means connectivity. It is a medium to connect to other people, other world. But it can be much more than that.
Okay, so I think I agree with most of what you all have said. That's also how I use the internet, primarily to connect with people and Google. So I'm going to talk a little technical stuff, but it's not that much. So somebody, Prabir, who's coming later today, will also talk about it, I think. So the internet consists of three layers. So there's the hardware layer, which is the router, the machine, and everything. And then you have the telecommunication layer, which carries the data packets that when we type in something, you know, the data goes and gets stored. And the last is the actual internet layer that we use. Now, each of these layers can be used to track you. And that's why I would like to talk about big data now. Because it's the idea of big data is that it's this explosion of digital data that's this collection of massive, excessive amounts of data that gets processed. And why is big data important for us? So Anita made this reference. I don't know how many of you all have watched this movie. So the idea in Die Hard 4 is that there's something called a fire sale. So because we live in an age where everything is online, there's this cyber terrorist who takes down the entire country just by pressing delete. And the entire system refreshes and all memory is erased. So everybody's history, all bank accounts are down to zero. So the idea, the reason why I'm talking about Die Hard is, other than the fact that I like the movie, is that I thought the idea was really, really scary. And after I thought about using it, I looked it up a little bit. I read some of these tech blogs. And so it's not actually possible in real life, but you could do it department-wise. So even though you can't take the entire government down at once, you could actually take it down by a department, which is really scary because, I mean, that lets us know the power of the internet. The other reason why I want to talk about big data is, I don't know how many of you all read about this. This is Sheryl Sandberg, the CEO of Facebook. And she recently apologized because Facebook in 2012 conducted this experiment where they changed the news feed of over 600,000 users to see if the content that comes on your news feed has an impact on your emotions and what you post. So that's really, really problematic for me because they're basically using us as guinea pigs and they're manipulating what we see. And we don't even know that they're doing that, right? So that's really scary. But one thing that struck me was that, you know, while they came out and they apologized, this is actually something that's happening to us on a daily basis. And so I'd like to talk about the filter bubble. Some of you all asked us about the filter bubble yesterday. So what the filter bubble basically is that there's an algorithm that, based on your past, determines what kind of things you might like. And so it personalizes information and gives you that on your news feed or whatever, even Google. So one of you all mentioned, I'm sorry, I don't remember who, said that, you know, when you listen to a sad song on YouTube, then the next 10 days, it's just giving you sad songs to listen to, which is crazy, right? So that's the issue with it. But the problem is larger than that, because then it creates a cocoon where you receive only one type of information. And that's what's happening in the left slide. You receive only blue dots of information. And the issue is that, A, you don't even know what's getting left out, because you don't know how big the conspiracy is. And B, you don't know how diverse it is, what's being left out. Because there's no way you can actually tell, right? It's just an algorithm that's determining for you. So if I like two diverse things, but I get only one type of information continuously, it's just, I mean, it's completely leaving out diversity in terms of the exposure that I have for information. There was this person, I don't remember his name, he did this experiment on Facebook. So for 24 hours, he liked everything that turned up on his newsfeed. And what happened was, at the end of the 24 hours, he didn't have any posts from his friends on his newsfeed. All he had was advertisements and other pages that he had liked. And they were all from views that were completely diverse from what he actually believed in. He says that he's a liberal, but he only got views from, you know, the conservative, and it was only one thought that kept coming up, and there were just advertisements all over. He didn't have a single post from a friend that turned up on his newsfeed. So that's really scary to think about it. We don't realize when we're liking something that, you know, it could actually lead to this, and they're collecting the data. The issue is that it creates this illusion of knowledge. And so this is something that just came up. I'm always on Facebook, so I tend to notice these things. This is a Dutch photographer. She just posted this, I think, a couple of days ago. What she did was she told her friends and her family that she's going on vacation. And she didn't go. She just took pictures, and she edited it out. And she made it look like she was on vacation. And, like, it looks so realistic. If I was looking at this picture, I would totally believe that she was there. So
the CP photograph you showed us first, did you fudge it?
No, I don't think I could do that. So I thought it was, in a very real sense, it talks about, you know, how easy it is to manipulate information. But I thought it's also a very good metaphor for the filter bubble. And that's why I thought I'll use this. There's just two more concepts that I want to talk about. The right to be forgotten. I know a lot of people brought this up yesterday. So the idea of right to be forgotten is exactly what it is. It's the right to be forgotten. So what happens now is that, suppose I post something on Facebook and then I delete it, I assume that it's gone forever. But the thing is that it gets stored, and that once you put it out there, it's out there. It doesn't matter whether you change your privacy settings, whether you delete it, it doesn't matter. So a more realistic example, which Nandini gave me and Anita gave me, was that suppose I'm in college and I do drugs once, and I get caught, and it's on my record, and then for the rest of my life, that information is going to be available online. So it's going to impact every single aspect of my life, because that information is out there. So the idea of right to be forgotten, which Argentina and France have accepted, as Anita mentioned yesterday, and the US Supreme Court has also recognized the importance of it, is that there's a need to think about how this impacts our lives on a daily basis. For a regular person who might commit a little petty problem, how that stays on record and how that creates an issue for the rest of their lives. I saw a very interesting video that counters this argument. So if you're interested, you should check out John Oliver's video on the right to be forgotten. He talks about how... I can't do justice to it because he's a comedian. So you should watch the video. He's really funny and he's very witty. So he takes the other side of the story, where he says that, you know, the moment the right to be forgotten was brought up in the US... all these murderers and rapists came and said, no, but I have the right to be forgotten as well. You know, so that's the flip side of it. The next thing I want to talk about is ICANN, which is the Internet Corporation for Assigned Names and Numbers. I'm going to ask Anita to help me out with this. But the idea behind the organization is that it assigns our domain names. And it's the only organization in the world that actually has control over assigning names. Now, what has happened recently is that they've changed their commercial model. And so what they started to do is they've started selling it. Before, they used to take a nominal fee. Now, they started selling it. And other than the regular .com, .org, .net, like now you have .book and .what was the other thing? Beauty that have come about. And so if you they sell it to the highest bidder, and that bidder is the only person who can use that. So basically, ICANN has claimed control over words. And that's really, really problematic. I want to ask you all a question now. Do you think the internet is global? Why?
Because in large sections of the population are
not part of it. They have never touched it, have never used it. It's global only notionally and potentially.
Okay.
In reality, I don't think it's global as yet.
Okay.
I don't know when it will happen, but no, I don't think it's global.
Okay.
So it has this aura of, you know, something akin to megalomania, to saying that, you know, Big Brother's watching you, you're in a filter bubble. It's true and it's not true, in the sense that if you're not in the filter bubble, if you don't put on your internet, ultimately you do hold the button, you can always press. You can choose not to be linked to it. You can choose not to get linked. You can choose not to be present on that. Ultimately, you do hold the button and the key. So I think there, and your it's only your online persona or your online presence that is recorded there. Your real life, that's a virtual life. The real life, I don't think the internet in a, other than in very practical things like booking a plane ticket or something. Other than that, I don't know how really it will work. Anita's expression tells me that she thinks I'm being simplistic, but I don't know. I just was wondering.
I'm thinking that it's a segue to, you know, kind of take the debate.
Yeah. I totally differ on this. It's not the one who uses is on the internet or in that lanes. It's everyone. There was a movie, Enemy of the State. That is one more interesting movie that shows how it. If someone decides they can control you anywhere, whether you are on net or not, and it's like a religion. Whether you follow it or not, it's there.
Yeah.
So internet is a new religion. So whether you are there, but you are all affected by it.
I just want to give one example, actually. I don't completely agree with you about if you don't use it, you're not there. Just a very simple example is that there's this...
Hello? Yeah. There's this application called Truecaller, which I don't have. But because other people have downloaded it and they have my number, it gets stored in their database. So now even if I don't have it, and the other person has it, they know that I'm the one who's calling them. And I didn't approve of them having my number. I didn't put my number on Truecaller. But they still have my number. Yeah. So even if I don't have that, they still have my data even if I don't have the application.
I can always change my number.
Something similar to what you were saying, which is, as a university student, this is something that affects me. You can buy so many books online, much cheaper than you can buy them in a brick and mortar store. And suppose I take the stand that I don't want to buy them online. I don't want to patronize Flipkart or Homeshop 18 or any of these websites. But I want to go to the university book shop and buy them from the bookseller. But the problem is not everybody thinks like me, and these stores are available and they offer services which this owner, this shopkeeper doesn't. and eventually his sales dip and maybe he has to shut down. So it's not about what I decided to do. It's about the fact that that facility is available and I am in an environment where it's available, and whether or not I like it is going to affect my life.
Yeah.
And perhaps, you know, when we're talking about this technology, the question isn't so much what we like or dislike about it. It's what it makes possible and what it makes impossible and how it changes our lives in ways over which we don't have any control, and over which we want to have some control, perhaps.
I think I also wanted to add that yesterday, I think, when we were playing those games, somebody said it also depends very much on, I think, Rohini, did you also mention that it also depends very much on which country you are in, where you are. You know, even if you were not using the internet and you were using some kind of other peer-to-peer technology which bypasses the mainstream internet, even then, in extremely strong surveillance states, you can be singled out. And so it's not so much whether you can press the button or not. I think also for people who are socially marked in many ways, in real life, offline, their transactions online make them that much more proportionately vulnerable, because there is a trace, and that's an issue.
Just to add to her point, I also feel like, or I would like to feel like I can choose to not be on the internet. But at least in my work, and with my family or community, a lot of the essential communication now happens through the internet. So I can't possibly do work if I don't use email. That's not an option for me anymore. So even if I choose to not want the internet, then I'm choosing much more than to not want much more than the internet. So just adding to her point.
Maybe you can come. Okay.
I just take that thought a little further. I was just thinking that there are certain things that move on. For instance, I have a great love. I mean, even now, I have not lost my love for shortwave radio. But where does one access shortwave radio technology? I mean, even to get a radio which will play those bands is no longer easy. You can't. And then the quality of the reception is so poor that you give up. But then it continues to exist. It's there somewhere. Okay, that's one thing. So it's all about FM and, you know, only locationally, you know. Otherwise, shortwave used to go around the world. It still does. But it's dropped out of our consciousness. And similarly, internet, I agree totally about email. But what about social media? You can choose to be there or not there. And I would say that much of the threat really comes from being a present in the social media. So you can choose not to be there.
Okay,
one quick point. Yeah.
I just wanted all the hands up so I can see how many hands. Okay, go ahead.
We are no longer in the state where we can draw a definitive line between online and offline. We are now highly networked, and in a way, security and privacy online, Alex sneezing, other people have to cover up so that you don't contract the disease. You cannot say that I won't contract it because I don't do this and that. It's like that. And let's say, you know, if someone's put a surveillance camera outside their house so that no one steals their bike, and you are on that footage. There are so many CCTV footages that are like streamed live on the internet, on beaches. Of course, I don't know any such footage from India, but from other countries, you can actually see these things. So people can see you are at this point, at this state, this point in time, you are at this place doing this because you're clearly visible in that. So I don't think it's even, you know, it's even tangible or practicable in any way to draw a line between the online and the offline, whether or not you are an entity that's
present online.
No, but I think the initial question which Roshni asked was, do you think internet is global? And for that, I would say no, because of the same reason which you stated first, that because also the readings also said that it has not reached all the places on the planet. So at that level, don't you think it's no still? I mean, it's not global really, because it's not reached even the rural parts of India, say. That way, I feel that no, it's not global. Okay.
No, but I think physical reality. But I also think that has to be unpacked. Are you coming to it?
Yeah.
Okay.
Hi. Responding to you, you know, you said that maybe you need a new social media and, you know, you can just use email. But I think it's essential to understand that, you know, which are the companies that are there, you know, on social media and email. You might increasingly find that the companies that are there, you know, the social media companies are also email providers. So, and especially because there is a lot of monopolization that is happening of late. So, you know, if you are using email, then you are on the internet. There is no way to say that you're not, and you know, you're just using internet and not using other things. So, and there are various ways by which, even probably you might not be using the internet or social media, but you're still a part of the larger ecosystem. Again, the two color equivalent, even if you don't want it, you might be. For example, even someone who say, living in a small town, village, probably not using the internet, but if he or she has relatives somewhere outside who use Truecaller, then Truecaller has your number and they are using these numbers. They are a part of the larger internet ecosystem. So this is just one of the ways, you know. So, to say that, you know, you might just use email and probably not use social media is, you know, it's a very simplistic position to take, yeah.
I think much of it has already been said. I think there are two, three strands that kind of emerged. One is, you know, when you say global and you link it with services that are being provided, like, you know, say Flipkart, the same logic also applies to the entire global marketing scenario. I mean, you didn't ask for so many brands of shampoos, but they're still out there. And today they are reaching the villages and, you know, you have 1 rupee sachets which are available for the people who never asked for it. And perhaps, you know, I think shampoos are the fearsome thing is that you get 5 rupees kurkure and 5 rupees ka lays when people are unable to afford millets and food which they should be eating. And I think that's one part of this debate about being global and what is happening in terms of figuring out what is that the people want and how are you designing, defining what is it that, you know, finding reason for your own production systems and for your own products. I think that's one part. And the other is the communication part. I think we need to differentiate the two, and the third one, of course, is also the surveillance issue, which I think is, they're all three different, but connected in some way. And the challenge is to be able to figure out how do you take a position vis-a-vis these three, because you do want communication to be global, Cynthia, like the shortwave, you know, so you do want to have some amount of, I mean, otherwise, imagine having to wait for, you know, 10 days for a letter to reach the US. And here you have it at a flip of a second. I think that's one part which is attractive to all of us, but I think the baggage that comes along with it is often invisible and unfathomable, and that's the scary part. So how do you reduce the scare and start engaging with it without the fear and more in a more rational way? I think that's what one needs to get at.
Yeah, agreeing with what Janvi said and also some earlier observations, I think the distinction between structure and personal choice has to be carefully negotiated here. And the internet is much about structure, what she was saying, that actually the bookshop closes down. You don't have the option. So we have limited personal choices. Personal choice remains important, but much of it is structural. And on a different point, I think when you're talking whether it is global, one of the most important things here is that it has led to emergence of a global elite, which is a new phenomenon. Earlier were the national elites oppressing the national oppressed. And
internet is both the basis and a tool of a global elite which has a new kinds of political economic assertion, which is very difficult to beat because politics is only weapon of the poor and the politics is local and national. And we have this problem. So internet is very, very global in terms of way it has produced a new globalized elite. And the unconnected are local and the elite is global, and that is a major fault line of the current social system.
So would you say that the global village doesn't happen on the internet?
Param,
that was a question for you. Would you want to take it?
No, I didn't say question to the whole
world.
Okay, all right.
So does it mean that the global elite is not, I mean, sorry, the global village doesn't exist or is, how do we see that? Because a global village is an important concept that sort of progress this thing forward.
Does anybody want to take that? Janvi. Janvi and then Usha.
I'm not about the global village.
Okay, then we'll finish the global village.
I wanted to take both a little bit of what Param said and the global village. See, I think that while the internet has come to India much later on, and you know, but I think the other part of global corporations, which are not about communication but about products, to that extent, a certain kind of globalization was put into position and has seen its tentacles much. Similar, but I think the whole communication era and the digital era has hastened the whole thing. So I don't think it's a new thing, but I think it is the pace at which it is taking place and the kind of people who are there now, I don't think are very different from what the earlier corporations and the, you know, the global hegemony of capital that was already existing. So I think that's a hastening and a different kind of
coming together.
On the global village, I mean, if you go back to what was understood at Vasudeva Kutumbakam, was very different. I think at that time, the focus was much more on the feeling of, it's a male word, of brotherhood, unfortunately. But I choose to, you know, as a feminist, choose to look at more the feeling of being together as human beings and not as... in this global village where there is consumerism is the key defining factor. I think that's the difference between understanding global village as a concept that was there from much earlier and the way global village is now being defined. I think we need, I would choose to see that as a difference.
Just to add a small point, yes, there it was always there, but there is a qualitative shift because there is a class consciousness being produced because this is such a submerged environment where you can actually live out your life, and that takes your political and social cohesion of the global elite to a high level and makes it a very strong and potent global phenomenon.
Can we go back to you? I think before the end of the session, maybe at some logical point that you think, I'd like Rohini, for you as a Wikipedian, to talk a little bit more about the right to be forgotten, because yesterday in one of the sessions, the first, you know, the icebreaker, a lot of people wanted to understand it in all its entirety. And while it's rather simple, I mean, it means what it means, there are alternative perspectives from the access to knowledge end. And so I'd like you to talk about it, but maybe after this theme gets done. Yeah.
Okay. What I was looking for, which Param talked about when he said, is the internet global, is online as well, what kind of information are we getting? Now, there's a huge hierarchy on the internet in terms of language, in terms of culture, in terms of ideas. I mean, just take a look at my presentation, which I said I will talk about. I mean, I'm making all mostly American pop culture references. And because, I mean, that's something that I'm interested in, but it also shows up most evidently when I Google something like filter bubble, then I get a talk by somebody who is a white male person. Not to discount what he's saying, but I think you get what I'm trying to say. About 60% of all web content is in English, whereas only 10 to 15% of the world population speaks English as a first language. It's important to understand that this all, the hegemony of language creates a hegemony of ideas as well. And so we should recognize that. Drawing on this idea, I'm going to talk about another concept as well. So Aircel, I don't know if you all have noticed, recently there's been an ad that's been coming, and that's how I realized. Aircel, I think, is now providing free Facebook and WhatsApp, which doesn't require a data pack or internet services. Now, what does this mean? It means that we're creating a monopoly wherein those who get in first have all the reign, right? And this is a clear violation of one of the concepts that we also spoke about in the brief, which is net neutrality. We're not providing an equal platform for everyone to come. And so we're creating a monopoly here. I'm just going to quickly talk about the rest because I think we're really out of time. This was a scandal that came out a couple of weeks ago. So I don't know if you all will recognize it. There was this iCloud hack where photos of a lot of celebrities, primarily women, was leaked online. And many of them were nude pictures, personal photographs that they had taken and put on their cloud. And that was hacked and leaked. So when we're talking about data storage, I think it's important to think about this and how we don't necessarily realize that this can happen, which is why I'm still talking about it in the green room of the internet. Because we just take a picture and we store it on a cloud so that we can access it anywhere else. But there's also this possibility. So now I'm going to come on stage. This is a campaign that Google ran to show the sexism that exists online. So I don't know if you can see it from there. Okay, it says women shouldn't, and you know Google has that predictable thing. So the most searches were women shouldn't have rights, women shouldn't vote, women shouldn't work, women shouldn't box.
Make that clear about the predictive thing.
So it's Google auto predicts based on the phrase that you're typing in. So it says if you're saying how can, then it provides you a list of things that you could possibly be searching for just to make your life easier, but it doesn't. So then the other one is women should, and the predictive phrases that come up are women should stay at home, women should be slaves, women should be in the kitchen, women should not speak in church. Now, after Google ran this campaign, they have very, very smartly removed the predictable or auto-predict for these particular phrases, but I would not be bogged down. So I tried multiple things, and this is what I came up with. Girls are better than boys. Not bad. Girls are like jokes.
So you came up with, you just typed.
I typed girls are, and these are the things that came up. So girls are like, are better than boys. Girls are like jokes. Girls are like apples. Girls are made of sugar and spice. I'm not sure how we will kind of process that, but okay. Then I typed women are. Women are from Venus, men are from Mars. Women are better than men. Women are like cats. So that happened. Okay, so when I'm talking about violence against women online, this is something that Dhruv mentioned, and he spoke about anonymity and how it can be good and bad. So I'm going to talk about the bad part. I don't know if you all know about this. He actually alluded to this yesterday. So this is the video game that he was talking about where you can it was hacked and you can rape women. So it's a multiplayer online game called Grand Theft Auto, and it's sold over 150 million units. So it's extremely popular. Grand Theft Auto 5...
Yes. Grand
Theft Auto 5... what he said was true. When the hack happened, what happened was that you could rape other participants, other players on the of the game. But in the game itself, as it exists without being hacked, there is one part which I looked up where you have to go rescue a woman who is being gang raped. So if you don't reach on time, they gang rape her and they kidnap her, and you're supposed to, as the man, go and rescue her before this happens. So we're still promoting this idea of violence, which is just ridiculous. I mean, it's scary and it's extremely graphic. I just avoided putting the pictures because I don't think it was appropriate. But this is just one example of how violence is promoted, and we kind of normalize it because we make it look cool, like, oh, okay, I'm just raping this woman, I'm rescuing this woman who's being raped, things like that. It's just unacceptable. So this is a video that came out last year. It's by this singer called Robin Thicke. And the song is called Blurred Lines, and it makes the no means yes argument. And this is a more censored version. Actually, the uncensored video has the women dancing naked, and the men are dressed in suits, and they're saying, I know you want it, but you're a good girl, so you won't say it. I know you mean yes. And he claimed it's a feminist song because the women want to express their sexuality, but it's really not. Just take a look at this picture. There are so many issues with it. So what I want to talk about is that through videos like this, it became very, very popular. Of course, people came out and spoke against it. But it became so popular, which helped me understand that, you know, the fact that these videos go viral kind of reiterates and justifies the violence that we're continuing to perpetrate, and this idea that, you know, it's okay to objectify women. Look at the number of people who have viewed it. It's 338,000, a million views. I mean, that's just ridiculous. Yeah. But it's not all bad. The internet has also been used for activism, as Dhruv was talking about. And the Pink Chaddi campaign, if you all will remember, kind of grew exponentially because of their Facebook page. But the flip side was that there was a huge backlash, and there was a lot of trolling, and finally Facebook shut the page down. So this brings me to the idea of censorship. The common dilemma which existed...
Does everybody know what this campaign was about?
No. Yeah. Sorry, I just made that assumption.
Does everybody want to know what it was about?
Okay.
How many people know about it?
Okay.
Please.
So, if you all recall, a couple of years ago, some women were attacked in Bangalore in a pub, right? So this was basically a reaction to that, where they started a campaign to send pink chaddis.
So, let me add a little bit more masala to it. So this is about our very own moral police.
Speak a little more into the mic.
Yes. So this is Valentine's Day, and there were women and men in this no longer very small town, and no longer peri-urban, but becoming urban town, Mangalore. In the pub, girls and boys were together. So our whatever Sena landed up there.
Sri Ram Sena.
Yeah, Sri Ram Sena, who think that the well-being of women is at their heart, landed up there, and they decided that they will get the women out and humiliate
them.
Yeah, and what they ended up doing was a whole lot of humiliation. Took pictures, it came all over the local media, etc. And in response to that, a lot of other activists in different parts of Karnataka, particularly starting with Bangalore, decided that they would put up a page online, and they used Facebook as the most available, easily accessible, reachable social media platform. So what did they do? They went and put this up, and they said, look, boss, what we need to do is, to the Sriram Sena head who lives in Mangalore, we should give him a very special gift. And no guesses for guessing? Yeah. So we will all send him, because we love him so dearly, we'll send him pink chaddis. So, and it was like this momentous response. So everyone is packaging pink chaddis and sending it in the name of Sri Rama. And it went to Mangalore. Now what is happening in the meanwhile is, for those who are not sending those pink chaddis, this Facebook page became like a very, very good platform
to come up and say who the heck, I mean, the whole Valentine's Day debate can be taken outside of this. I mean, there might be other issues with all of that and how we problematize consumerism, blah, blah. But the fact remains that nobody actually can get into a pub and tell the girls what they ought to be doing, right? So this platform, in that sense, served as a very important vehicle. But the part that comes after this is that there was tremendous upheaval because it became extremely political. This, there were counter views and people started jamming and coming on to Facebook and expressing
trolling.
Alternative, trolling the site basically.
Yeah.
So the volume on the site got so much, of transaction on the site got so much that it became a problem for Facebook. Right? So without any explanation, Facebook simply shut down the page. So this is a very complex case study. The case study is that the platform was available. Feminist activists used it brilliantly. They not only used it to do ask you to send pink chaddis, but they also used it for actual outside Kabban Park. They were in Bangalore city, in different cities in Karnataka. People came, just, they gathered and they said, down with moral policing. All of that happened and the site then, repeated appeals were made by the initial group of feminists to Facebook saying, what the hell? Mm-hmm. I mean, why are you taking this site down? Where is your explanation? But no explanation was received. There was, I think, there's a Wikipedia entry about this and you can actually look it up. So the explanation was like this very cursory one-liner which basically said that, you know, we can't put it back. So it was like a kind of an anticlimactic end to what seemed to be like the power of organizing on Facebook. And I think the fact that it was Facebook and Facebook decided arbitrarily on its own to censor the site is a very vital point for our own discussions and understanding.
Can I just add one small thing? Yeah. That it's, and no one asked how did Ram Sena and what was its reaction to this?
Yeah.
You know, flood of physical presence of pink chaddis landing up on their doorstep. They took a note and they said, they're all our sisters. So what we are going to do is send them back saris and bangles.
But
this
was, the
sari, they would love to receive. But that's what they said. No, we are sending sari and bangle back to them. So ultimately, these fellows, they try to have the last
word.
Yeah, no, the last word on these things.
I'm sorry? So trolling is where you basically criticize the focus of a particular thing. So it happens a lot on these websites. If you see, you know, comments that come on articles and things like that where there's basically a lot of bashing. And usually trolling is very, very abusive and hate speechy. So that's what trolling is.
Usha, do you want to add something at that point? I'm sorry.
Oftentimes people are hired to troll as well. It's a conspiracy. Yeah. So the last thing I want to talk about is censorship. So one of the things that it's been discussed by feminists in general, and there's usually this debate about how do we allow for women to have the right of expression, but how do we also protect their rights from being violated? This is especially in the case where they have the right for sexual expression. So when I'm talking about censorship, I don't necessarily mean just that, you know, you're not allowed to post something, but also the pressure that comes from behind from society to prevent them from posting certain things. Now, in the run-up to the 16th Lok Sabha elections, Sagarika Ghosh posted a lot of things criticizing Modi, and so there was a huge backlash. This was on Twitter, and this is actually the most PG-13 Twitter post that I found because there are some extremely horrifying, I would have had to blacken out the whole thing and you'd just see at Sagarika Ghosh, that's it. So, parental guidance 13, so where you need parental, so it's for, yeah, it's for movies, you know, the censor board ranks movies, right? So, U is universal, A is adult. I used it because the other ones are extremely explicit, so I would not be able to, yeah, so I would have to censor it so and not allow for freedom of expression for the people who are posting this. So that's something that I wanted to point out, that when we're talking about censorship, it's not just the censorship that they faced in terms of you're not allowed to post something, but also the pressure that occurs that prevents people. So Sagrika Ghosh, after she faced all this, she said that I'm not going to express my political views on Twitter anymore. So I think it's important to think about it beyond just, you know, not being allowed to post something. And the same thing happened with Meena Kandaswamy as well, who's a Dalit poet. She spoke out about allowing beef to be served in Osmania University. And she also faced a lot of flack for that on her Facebook and Twitter pages. So,
secretly, she continues to be targeted by
trolls. Yeah, she, though she, I think on Facebook, I checked out her page, she seems to also have gathered a lot of support. So there are people who are also, you know, coming out and saying, this is rubbish, what is this? And supporting her. But yeah, there is a lot of trolling online. So the last concept I want to talk about is intermediary liability, wherein so internet service providers and internet companies that own social media, are they liable for illegal activities that occur on their space? So this is a debate that's been going on. In some countries have laws about it, but the idea is basically to say that, to give an example that Anita gave me was, suppose I post something on Facebook and you don't like it. It's objectionable and you don't like it, then you can report to them saying that I don't like this, please remove it, it's hate speech, right? So then Facebook will send you back a report within 24 hours saying yes or no, depending on whether it abides with their policies. So, most of the time it's no, yeah, because I have also signed up petitions where they have extremely horrifying pages about, you know, boobs, tits, and God knows what, and things like that, which you try to take down. They've stolen pictures and put it on the page, and then when you try to take it down, they're saying, no, but you know, this is our policy, it's fine. So, are they liable? The other side of the story is that, you know, governments can also do that. Like, and we have seen that a lot lately with, you know, women facing flack, or people facing flack for what they've said on social media in real life. Right. So, does the government have control to ask Facebook to say, okay, take this down, this is not okay by us, or not? So, this is a debate that's going on, but I thought I should just point this out.